that has so much to offer, the Catholic faith, the faith of the Church founded by our Lord Jesus Christ. As we discuss the glories, the mysteries, as well as questions and even misunderstandings and concerns about the Church, join us here in Voices of Faith. Good day and welcome once again to another episode of our program, Voices of Faith. I'm Carlos Antonio Palad, an associate member of Defensores Fidei Foundation, president of Filipinos for Life, and a member of the board of Pro-Life Philippines. Last May, Pope Francis surprised the entire Catholic Church by announcing that the Synod of Bishops, scheduled for the year 2023, will be preceded by a synodal process that includes listening to all of the baptized, to all Catholics, and even to those who are not practicing Catholics, and even to those who are not in the church, in every local diocese before the bishops gather again. So there will be a two-year process before the actual Synod of Bishops in 2023, which will be held in Rome. The timeline for the synodal process, which started just this month, is you had Pope Francis opening the event in the Vatican on October 9 and 10, and then from October 17, 2021 until April of 2022, there will be phase one, during which the process will be held in all Catholic dioceses, in which the church, the local churches, will listen to as many as possible, Catholics and non-Catholics practicing and non-practicing. And each diocese will then have its own pre-synodal gathering to produce a summary to be submitted to the National Bishops' Conference. And then after that, during a period of discernment, the National Conference will review the texts received from the local dioceses and compose its own document to be submitted to the Vatican. The Vatican officials will then create a first draft that will be discussed from September 2022 to March 2023 by the bishops meeting at the continental level. So all the Asian bishops will meet, the African bishops will meet, those in North America will meet, those in South America, those in Europe. And in gathering, they then will create a next round of texts that will also be submitted to the Vatican. And these drafts, these documents, will form the basis of what the bishops will actually discuss in October 2023, phase three, when the bishops actually meet in Rome. This is probably the first time that we will have, actually, this is the first time that we will have meetings of this magnitude in every diocese. And many expect it to be a turning point, or to at least to be a very important milestone in the history of the church. But what exactly is this all about? What are these synodal meetings all about? What are these meetings all about? What is synodality or synodality? To guide us in understanding this, we have invited a very special guest. He is a pastor at the Nuestra Señora del Perpetuo Socorro Parish in Sampaloc, Manila. And he is the vicar forain of the Vicariate of Our Lady of Loreto in the Archdiocese of Manila. He also serves as the Executive Secretary of the Permanent Committee on Public Affairs of the Catholic Bishops Conference of the Philippines. And one of his main concerns is church-state relations. He finished theology and canon law at the University of Santo Tomas and has his master's degree in public administration from the University of the Philippines, National College of Public Administration and Governance. Without further ceremony, let us welcome Father Jerome Secillano. Welcome to the program, Father Jerome.
Thank you, Carlos. And I'm glad that you have me here. And I hope that we are going to have a fruitful discussion. Mm-hmm.
Thank you, Father, for your time and for agreeing to be on this program and to answer our questions about this whole process. So let's start. What is the meaning of synod or synodality? What are the meaning of these terms, and how can we best understand these here in the Philippines in our own context?
Okay, number one, synod is a gathering of bishops. Mm-hmm. from not only the Philippines, but from around the world. So when it is called by the Vatican, so it's a gathering of bishops from around the world. But if it is a gathering from a particular country, okay, that's a gathering also, or that a national conference of bishops in that particular country. But then there may be lay people who will also be invited. And then experts also, even priests, may be invited in the synod to provide experts' advice, especially on the topic that will be discussed. And then when we speak of synodality, it's about the church joining together with the hierarchy, including the lay people. So I don't want to be very technical about this explanation, but imagine a person walking together. So I am walking with you, Carlos. If we walk together, there is an element of discussion. There is an element of dialogue. Maybe you will be the one to talk and I will listen. And there will be times also that I will be talking and then you will be listening. So picture two people walking together, conversing with one another, dialoguing, listening, talking. That's synodality. And who are the main actors in the so-called synodality? I mentioned already that there will be bishops, those who belong to the hierarchy. There will be lay people. And you mentioned also in your introduction that it's not only about the Catholics, but it's also about listening to people from other faiths. And the lay people will be very, very on hand to participate in the consultation process. So that's synodality, Carlos.
Thank you for that explanation, Father. And so you have now explained to us synodality. Why is this so important to Pope Francis? Before Pope Francis, there have been synods of bishops, but we didn't really hear that much about it as we now do under Pope Francis. So why is this so important for him?
Well, I think with Pope Francis, he would want the church really to be very inclusive. And that's one consideration. Even at the start of his papacy, he would always actually emphasize that the church should be very, very inclusive in a sense that the church is not only about the hierarchy. I'm going to give you a very short background of the understanding of the church. Mm-hmm. Prior to the Second Vatican Council, the church is more or less known to be a hierarchical church. Mm-hmm. But then in the advent of the Second Vatican Council, the definition of the church differed. Mm-hmm. Now it's called the people of God. And when we speak of the people of God, it's composed of three groups. Number one will be the clerics. Number two will be the lay people. And number three will be the religious. The clerics, those who are ordained to the ministry, the bishops, the priests, and the deacons. When we speak of religious, they can also be bishops, they can also be priests, they can also be deacons, but belonging to religious congregations, including the sisters. But the lay people, those who are baptized. So imagine now the image of the church composed of these three main groups. And so therefore, it is a mass that we talk to one another, then we dialogue, and then we listen to each other so that we can further strengthen the relationship that exists between and among these groups. And I guess Pope Francis would like to reinforce that idea. He doesn't want people to think that the church is only about the hierarchy. Mm-hmm. Maybe Pope Francis wants really people to understand that you are the church. And when I speak of people, it's actually the baptized. You are the church. You belong to this church. So no longer would I want a church that is only being run or governed by the ordained ministers, but even in the governance of the church, the participation, the collaboration with the lay people, they are very crucial. And I guess that's the background or the context why Pope Francis seems to take interest in the synodality.
Thank you for that. So it's not about, it's no longer about having a, you can say this, or rather, if I may begin again. There's this common misperception among a lot of our fellow Catholics, especially here in the Philippines, that the church refers simply to the bishops and the priests and the deacons. But in this synodality, we're actually encouraged to be reminded of the fact that the church is all of us. We are the church. We are all of us who are baptized, all of us who are in the Catholic Church, we form the church. And so we also have this shared responsibility in living the life of the church, of course, not just the sacraments, but also even in evangelization and in spreading the good news. So that having been mentioned, in the synodal process, there's also talk of consulting or speaking with or dialoguing with non-Catholics or Catholics who have fallen away, who are no longer practicing. And what's the goal of this, Father?
Well, I think that's part of being inclusive. You know, in the Middle Ages, there's also this saying that outside the church, there is no salvation. Mm-hmm. But now it was debunked. So we wanted, I think, to make it known that somehow the church also takes care of people who have gone astray. You mentioned about those who are not anymore practicing Catholics. Mm-hmm. We want to reach out to them. And you also mentioned about people who may not belong to the Catholic fold. But we also want to listen to them. So I think that's part of being inclusive, at least in the aspect of listening. You know, we can very well have a complete image of the church if we try to consider also not only the ideas of those who are now in the church, who are so active in the church, but also try to listen to the ideas, to the aspirations of those outside of this church, including those who are not anymore practicing the faith. So I guess Pope Francis would like to reach out to these people so that at the end of this process, at the end of this synod on synodality, we may now have a concrete, and a very clear image of what the church should be, especially in these modern times. A church who responds to the needs of the people, a church who's really effective in ministering to the people, and also effective because he has the lay people. She has another lay people on her side, joining together, ministering together in the world.
Mm-hmm. So, Father, during these consultations prior to these actual or the concluding Synod of Bishops in 2023, the point really here is to hear from the whole church their ideas, their aspirations. Some might even say the dreams of the people of God, of the baptized and even those who are not formally part of the church, so that the church will know where to go. Would that be an accurate way of saying it?
It's not only about that the church would know where to go, but it's about establishing an identity for the church. You mentioned also a while ago that, and I also mentioned that before it was more of a hierarchical church. Mm-hmm. But now we want to emphasize that we are the church. So I'm speaking as a priest, but I include you in this church. So we are the church. Mm-hmm. And so therefore, it's not just about where do we want to go, but it's about establishing what kind of church we'd like to be in order that we may be effective in ministering to the people. You know, it starts with identity. So if our identity is more hierarchical, so I guess the people will just look at us as priests, only waiting for priests to do things for them. But now, we are expecting that after these consultations and after the synod itself, we may now have a very concrete expression of synodality in which people are really collaborating with one another and now joining with each other with joy. And in peace. So I think those are the things that we expect, after this synodality, synod on synodality. Mm-hmm.
And here in the Philippines, you know, I sometimes make a point of asking my friends on Facebook if they have heard of this or that process or development in the church. And I asked about, prior to October 17, I asked about what were the parishes and dioceses doing about the synod. I posted a question about that and I got only a couple of responses. So my question is, here in the Philippines, what are the preparations? What are the processes that you are aware of regarding the actual holding of pre-synodal consultations in the local parishes and dioceses?
Perhaps you will recall, even in social media posts, that last October 17, it was the launching of the Synod on Synodality here in the Philippines and I think around the world. So many of the dioceses in the Philippines celebrated Mass of the Holy Spirit, invoking the Holy Spirit to aid us in this consultation process. Mm-hmm. So that was October 17. And then in the Archdiocese of Manila, for example, the Sunday after October 17, the parish has also launched the consultation process. And we also call it Mass of the Holy Spirit. So in short, in this consultation process, we are banking on the participation of the lay people. There will be questionnaires that will be distributed to them, and we expect that our parishioners will be able to answer all the questions posed to them. And then we are going to collect all the answers, then collate them. And then I, as a vicar foreign, I am going to collect the answers also in my vicariate and then collate them and then submit them to the Secretariat of the Archdiocese of Manila. And then if the Archdiocese of Manila was able to gather everything, and then the Archdiocese, all Archdioceses and Dioceses will be submitting their report to the National Conference, to the CBCP itself. And then the CBCP will forward the collated responses to the Vatican. So that will be the process. So meaning to say, it's expansive in a sense that we are going to look at the different sectors that we have, including the poor, the ordinary employees, the LGBTs will be consulted also, the government officials. So I think we are trying to make it really expansive and exhaustive. And so therefore, we are expecting that the fruits of this consultation will indeed be very advantageous, you know, not only for the Church of the Philippines, but for the whole Catholic Church in the world.
That, well, it sounds like a huge process. You know, I can just imagine collating the responses would take a lot of time. So will you be having, you know, parish volunteers to help? Would you be open to that?
Definitely. In the aspect of collecting perhaps the responses of the lay people and all the other sectors that we are going to respond to these questionnaires. Of course, we may be needing some people also to help us in doing that. But the bulk of the work will be, of course, for the vicar foreign and then, of course, a parish priest. But then when we speak of parishes, for example, I am very sure that parish priests will be tapping the services of those working in the church, especially the parish pastoral council or any other organizations that the parish priest deemed worthy of participating in this endeavor. So that means even in the consultation process and even those working to collect these consultation results, they will already be tapping the services of the lay people and maybe even the religious. So it's indeed a collaboration between and among all these groups, you know, that comprise the church.
In this time, we're still grappling with COVID era restrictions, and so a lot of meetings are still being held over Zoom. You know, just like what we're doing right now, we're actually recording this over Zoom. And will online consultations be held? In addition to, will online consultations be a significant portion of the consultations as part of the synod, or will you be preferring face-to-face or physical presence and physical consultation?
What is important here in the consultation is to have the form, meaning to say the form, that we really have the responses on hand. So it's not just going to be recorded, mm-hmm. but we need the written responses of the people that we're going to ask. And so therefore, even if perhaps we are not going to do that by Zoom, I think we will just send them all the papers that they need to answer. And then they in turn will return these papers to us. So even if there will be no consultations like this that we are having right now, maybe using social media, but I think it will still be very effective in the sense that we will get the responses really from the people because they will have the forms, you know, who will be given to them.
So these forms will be made available and people can fill them up.
Yes, definitely it will be made available. And I guess dioceses around the Philippines have already prepared all these papers. And here in the Archdiocese of Manila, for example, we already have those questionnaires already. And it's just a matter of time before we distribute it to the different different parishioners and the different sectors for them to answer.
Mm-hmm. But all of this really is new. No? I've been a Catholic for some time, obviously since birth, and I've never heard of a consultation like this. So I'm guessing it's new. The process is new for nearly all of us, and I guess it will be very interesting how it unfolds. Now, my question is: I also saw someone, a lay theologian, actually forming his own kind of. Doing his own consultations online, saying, you know, please post on my Facebook page what you would, if you want to take part in the consultations. And I've also read that in some other countries, you have lay people on their own initiative coming together, coming forward to put their heads together and think about what they would like to tell the church, you know, in the context of these synodal, pre-synodal consultations. Is this something that the church actually permits or encourages?
Well, maybe it's not actually part of the whole process, but the initiative of the lay people will be very crucial also in the sense that any contribution that they can make for as long as they coordinate with the proper authorities, I think will be valid. Mm-hmm. So maybe these lay theologians that you speak of have, in one way or another, contacted also those people who are behind the consultation process. Mm-hmm. So I'm not really sure about the circumstances, but for them to really take the initiative, it's a good thing because that will be a good contribution also for giving us a glimpse of what our church is and what do we want as a church. And so the final step, I think, is for them to coordinate with the diocese, whoever is in charge of all the consultations or the process, so that everything that they need may also be included as the final response, you know, the collected report that we are going to submit to the proper authorities.
Mm-hmm. So, thank you for that clarification. Now, I have last two questions before we wrap up because time is running out on our short program. The first one is, I also see voices, mainly abroad, but I've also seen comments like this here in the Philippines. Some are saying that all of these consultations are just for show and that there already is a kind of pre-written agenda that will be brought out after a couple of years. What can you comment about those fears, as you can, perhaps?
Well, I think those are unfounded fears. You know, all these criticisms against the church, criticisms against Pope Francis, many of them are actually unfounded. You know, we are doing this not for the sake of glorifying a particular person, not for the sake of advancing whatever agenda the church has. But I think Pope Francis is doing this because authentically, we need really to have a good idea or an authentic idea of what the church is all about. Mm-hmm. So I guess by doing this, we do not cast aspersion on whatever motive the organizers have I think this is a good step in the right direction, in the sense that this is inclusive, this is collaborative, and I don't know what kind of agenda that these critics have by trying to downplay the importance of this synod on synodality.
Mm-hmm. So ito rin pong synod, this synod is not just going to be the usual church people or the usual church cliques meeting together and coming up with their own ideas. So this is really intended to hear what everyone who wants to take part in the process has to say.
Well, the fact that the lay people are included in the consultation, I don't think the lay people belong to some cliques from within the Vatican walls. So there has been criticisms that the church is very hierarchical, that lay people are not even welcome to work in the church. And even if they are welcome to work in the church, they are only given very limited roles. But right now, there is a massive consultation. And I think even in the Vatican, during the Synod on Synodality, we expect lay people also to play a very prominent role. And so I don't think we should give credence to that assertion that this is all about the work of a clique from within the church. I don't think so. Okay. So we have to downplay such kind of criticism, mm-hmm. because we want also to give credence to the initiative of Pope Francis and to the people behind this synod. I think they're doing the right thing. I told you a while ago that we need really to strengthen our grasp of what the church is. And we have been given the idea of what the church is prior to the Second Vatican Council. Then the Second Vatican Council, the world is evolving. So I guess if we consider all the circumstances, I guess the church should also have a modern identity, if I may say that.
Thank you for those clarifications and for those assurances, Father. So we really should encourage all Catholics, as definitely those who are listening to our program, we should encourage them to get in touch with their pastors, with their parish priests, with their bishops, and have their say during this process.
Yeah, definitely. We encourage them. And at the same time, they should be very open. Mm-hmm. Do not hold back. If they write their responses, there should be an element of honesty. They should not fear, because they are not going to be criticized. They are not going to be punished for saying the truth. I'd like them to be very honest, to be very truthful, and I like them to really participate in the process.
Thank you, Father. So there won't be suddenly squads, knocking on the door saying, why did you write this to the parish priest? No? It's not like that. No? Okay, so thank you for responding to our questions, Father, and thank you for explaining this whole synodal process or pre-synodal process to our listeners. Before we go, because we've actually just about run out of time, can you please lead us in a very short prayer, perhaps, and a final blessing.
God, our Father, we thank you for these opportunities that you're giving us as a church. Please give us a sense of openness, of courage, so that we may proclaim what is really in our hearts. And whatever it is that we proclaim, assure us also that it is always you who is the object of our faith. Grant this through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Thank you, Father. Thank you for your time. And so we've come again to the end of another episode of Voices of Faith. Please join us next time as we continue to explore the riches of the church founded by our Lord Jesus Christ.